Hello and welcome to Ashton Cadet for round 6 of the World TBO Championship Series. This is the last round, last race of the season, and the top few places for the Drivers' Championship are very tight. I apologize, I forgot to do a graphic for the drivers' standings, but here they are. In a photo, in a screenshot of the PDF. First is Joe Holmes of My3ID Gaming with 489 points, with 3 wins, 4 podiums, and 4 starts. So every race he's been on the podium. Second is the 09 of Nicky for Dakovic with Action Racing, SimSports, sorry. He has 466 points. Isaac Price in the number 99 NX Racing XRT has 415 points. Fourth is number 27 Last Lap Motorsport, Mandagas Stankus, with 237 points. Fifth is Tony. I'm sorry, I can't. I'm gonna apologize now for my bad pronunciation of names. Fifth is 98 Core Racing XRT Tony, and he has 220 points. So here are the team standings. In its racing is first with 755. Second is Action Racing with 634 points. My3ID is in third with 489. Last Lap Motorsport takes the fourth position with 209. Fifth is Core Racing with 259. In sixth place is Savage SimSport with 173. Seventh is Racing Pro Motorsport, sorry, with 161 points. Speed Desire is in eighth with 158. Race Dream Motorsport is ninth in with 149 points, and the Lithuanians are in tenth with 138 points. So here are some scenarios for the Drivers' Championship. After this, these are only a few of them. Full detailed report is by our race director Cameron Corns is at y.ly/BV9. Here are just a few of them. So if Joe Holm wins the race, he wins the championship regardless of where anyone else comes. If Joe Holmes gets pole and finishes second, he'll win the championship regardless of anyone else's position. If Nikifor Takovic wins the pole for the race, he wins the championship regardless of anybody's results. Championship tiebreaker will go to Joe Holmes in all cases in which he tied due to his 3 wins. Championship tiebreaker will go to Isaac Price over Nikifor Daković if Isaac Price finishes on the podium and Nikifor Daković fails to finish in the top 5. So, as I said, more detailed report and a lot more scenarios are at that link at the bottom of your screen now. Let's look at the track for today. It is Aston, with high live weather from the United Kingdom. We are still yet to know what the weather will be. The race director has not told me yet, but I will get that to him from him soon. This course is 1.870 kilometers long, 7 turns. running anti-clockwise. We raced it to 151.47 kilometers, which is 81 laps. So, we now have a Facebook page and a Twitter page. Like Relish Nashville on Facebook at the link on your screen now. If you have any questions for me or one of the admin team, on Twitter, if you use the hashtag WTVOCS, I have my tweet deck open, so I will be able to answer those as best I can. So, we are currently in the first qualifying session. We do have two groups running. We will have two groups of qualifying. I'm not sure how they do the groupings, but we currently have we currently have number 36, 99, 16, 22, 33, 77, 88, 34, and one that I just missed, who I've completed laps at the moment. Joe Holmes is the fastest with a 56.94, according to the tracker, and I think that's young. Oh, it is, right. So, you are free, drivers are free to pit and spectate as much as they want in this session. You'll see some people like Isaac Price now coming out of the pit lane. And my viewer thing has just frozen. That's great. Anyway, I have no idea which way the championship is going to go, as Joe Holmes just did a weird spin in the middle of the track. Don't know why, but he did. And honestly, I don't mind who wins it. All the top three drivers are very good drivers. Obviously, Joe Holmes has the advantage because he's first. Obviously, going into this round. Let's have a quick rundown of the top few drivers. Bear with me a sec, please. I'm just looking at my RRD viewer so I can view the action on the stream PC. It would like to work for me. Anyway, you can see it, but I can't. But let's have a go. Run through of the top few drivers in this qualifying session. I'll refresh the page so I can just up to date visuals. So number 36, Joe Holmes, is in first with his 56.94. Sorry about that. Isaac Price in the number 99 in a Tracing XRT is second with a 56.99. Frank Cinchetti in the number 22 XRT. Renault Coupe, sorry, is in third, the number 16 car, with a 57.16. Now, number 22, Frank Cinchetti. Has a 57.42. Number 33, Velletri, I'm sorry if I'm gonna mess a load of these names up today. Is the number 33 with in sixth place with 57 with a sixth, sorry, with a 57.1 51. Sorry, I'm getting a bit tongue-tied today. Robin Triscott's in the number 77 as a 57.53. The number 88, Michael, for Conquest Racing in the XRT has a 57.89. Ronnie Trompas in the number 96 race green autosport car has a 58.01, and Kasper Korsbeck for R-Force number 34 is in ninth with a 58.94. You can obviously see the tracker on the right of your screen. I do not know what you're viewing at the minute, because this isn't working. Oh, yes, I can now. No, I can't.
You're missing the 41, who is in fourth place with a 57, 40, or 37. He's not on the tracker, but he is on the server.
Okay, thank you to Racetrucks for telling me that. I shall fix it in the tracker. Oh, that was probably one of my mess ups. Well, could be anyone else's, because I'm the only one doing it. So I will change car so you're not bored. Isaac Price, who is the leader with a 5690, I think. 5690 is a very good lap for me, the fastest car on the track at the moment. I will just be adding this car that I missed out from the tracker, and I shall put it in now.
This qualifying session today could be a very meaningful one, with the 5-point bonus for the pole. That means that should Nicky Fordakovich win the pole and the race, it wouldn't matter what Joe Holmes did. However, should he not win the pole and win the race, Joe Holmes would, if Joe Holmes wins, rather, the pole and finishes second, it wouldn't matter what Nicky did. So this could be a very important qualifying session. As you can see now, Isaac has a 0.04 second lead in this session, and Nicky will be in the second group of this qualifying session. Once again, we decided to go into two groups so that the track wouldn't become so cluttered. Comes Joe to finish his lap, and with that lap, he is able to take the pole away from Isaac Price. The first group of qualifying has 3.5 minutes remaining at this time. Once that's over, we'll allow them to finish their laps, and then group number two will be out on the track. This will be the group which will include the fastest in our practice session before this race, which would be the 27 of Magunga Stankus, sorry if I mispronounced that name, and Nikifor Dakovic, who will be contesting for the championship today.
So that was the voice of Karen Collins, our race director, improvising while I sorted the tracker out. So I did miss the number 41, who is currently 6th with a 57.36 lap time. I will move the camera again because I know you're getting bored. So, Joe Holmes sets a new lap time, new fastest lap time of 56.78. He is just ahead of Isaac Price, 56.99, sorry. Bruno Coutts is in third with a 57.14. In fourth is Robin Driscoll, with a 57.21, and finally in fifth is 22 of Frank Cinchetti, with a 57.35. As I think I have messed 41's confirmation thing up again on the tracker, so he still isn't visible. Sorry for the delay. We get to keep commentating in a minute. That should work now. Right.
Isaac Price is coming around the final corner on his final qualifying lap.
As he goes up the hill and is just about to cross the line, see if he gets any quicker. He is still second with a 56.90. You are looking at nothing right now, so I shall change your view. This is, we're currently looking at the number 22, Frank Cinchetti. 41 still isn't showing the thing. That's your problem.
Forty-one has moved up to third with a 57.10. I'd like to point out that the lap time of record by Joe Holmes at a 56.78 is only 0.06 off of world record.
So everyone is everyone from that group, sorry, is now spectating. We are waiting for group number 2 to come out any moment now. As we're waiting, I think I'll make sure the track is Not playing up. Should be okay now. We can have 20 minutes of the session remaining, but they could be the Cameron Coyne's race director could be extending that if this doesn't happen. Group 2 is now coming out. Nicky Dakovic is the first car out of pit lane. He will be the first to well, he is the first to exit as he warms up his tyres, and yay, the tracker is now working. Yeah, if you have any questions for me or one of the administration team, please don't hesitate to tweet us with the hashtag WTBOCS. I will answer as many questions as I can in the time I am looking. I'd like to say a big thank you to Cameron Coyne for the administration of this series this year. Very good job he's done, as well as all the other admins. There's been quite a few behind the scenes that most people don't even know about, but they do an amazing job, and without them we wouldn't be here now. Well, we would be here now, but not looking at this, to be politically correct. So let's see if anyone has done a lap. So the first car, Nicky Dakovic, he is on his lap now. He coming down onto one of the, I think the one I never get, the corner that I never get right.
He will not be happy enough to lap time.
That corkscrew type corner, which I never get right, is a pain in the backside, because you need to get drift in there, your tyres heat up, and Dakovic goes 12th with a 58.74. I'm going to note down the numbers that were in group 1 so I don't read them out again. If I can find a pen. And I've lost it. Sorry, qualifying is quite. I'm not very good at qualifying reports. But I shall change your camera. Hopefully, there's something interesting. Let's go on any onboard lap with Nico Dakovic, as TV director doesn't like that, so he won't go on board. I will try and fix that later as he spectates. Looks like the only RB4 here today is this car, the number 20, which is the Racing Pro Motorsports RB4. His fastest lap is a 58.19. The XRT seems to be the fastest on almost every track, on with a few exceptions. The FXO can be fast if driven properly, and the only problem with the FXO is the tyres can wear quite fast. But if you're a good driver, a smooth driver, you should have no problems with that. As he spins, as it looked, warming up your tyres. As he goes off on the dash again, as he pits. I would after that. Get the tyres. Quite a few nice skins that these drivers are using today. I do like this black, white, and pink one. of the number 30, which is Casper Pontio. His fastest lap at the minute is a 58.25. It just did then a 59.43. Not faster, but there is still time to go. So you can like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter, which you can see at the top of your screen. All the links are there. I do apologise for my mess up with the link to Facebook in round 5 stream. I think it was round 5. Yes, the West Hill round. I have got it right now, and I've checked. Right. So you are now looking at the track from an odd angle. As my phone goes berserk for some reason. I will just restart TV director, so we can get the onboard cameras. When I can find the correct link. And restart TV director. So, let's see if the onboard now work. No. We're working before. Sorry about this. Give me a few minutes and we should be going again. You can, from this you can just see the amount of the steepness of the slope going down into the corkscrew type corner, then back up to the final hairpin. Let's just get TV director to be happy. Yep, I am correct. They should work now. TV director on. Go and see if we can do an onboard. There we go. Happiness. Sorry about that. we are currently on board with the number 65 of Eunice Koskinen. And he hits the tires and spins there. So we'll see if we can get an onboard lap with someone. This is the 38R, who is currently 16th into first turn one here. Not much camber there, but quite a simple corner. This is turn two and three, a right left chicane, leading on to turn four. Get this wrong, you can go onto the right hand side, and if you go on the right hand side here, there are many bumps into the corkscrew, flicking it in and flicking it back out, then hopefully go around into the last corner. Sometimes this falls away from you. In some cars, I don't think it does in these, but in some cars, I know the track to sort of fall away and disappear sometimes. We'll go through the top six drivers now. Let's reload the tracker so we're not behind. So, Joe Holmes is in first with a 56.78. Isaac Price is second with a 56.9. Mindigus Stankus is 56. Bit of a hazard. Did a 56.95. He is the fastest FXO in third. In fourth is Nicky Fudakovic with a 57.09. 41 is in fifth. Visa is from the Aitchin SimSport XRT team. He has a 57.1. The number 79 is in sixth with a 57.12. So the top three all in the 56-second mark. Everyone is under a minute on this track. The difference between first and 19th at the moment is about 2 or 3 seconds, I think. So a bit closer than usual, to be honest. As it's a smaller circuit, usually is closer times, but as you see there, our pace car for today, one of the realistic NASCAR admins piloting that very nice design FZ5 safety car. Sobis is the pace car driver in that car. He'll be controlling the field if he is ever needed. I've not seen many incidents of such spins in practice, so I'm not sure if he'll be have a quite boring day today. But he also stewards the race as well, so he can keep up to date. Sorry, no. That was random. He looks at replays and decides about any protests This is the number 30, who is currently 14. Kasper Kuntio, who has now spectated, and you are looking at nothing again. Maybe again. We'll go to another car. Actually, 38 comes in to complete yet another lap. With it, he did a 57.77, which is his personal best. So that puts him up to 15th. That lap was 0.17 faster than his personal best. Oh yes, I forgot to say, if you want to get the full tracker results, go to tracker.iden-racing.net/realisticnascar. I shall put a link on the top bar where you see the scrolling text. Update it. So, Joe Holmes is still first with a 56.78. 0.03 is now the number 27 of Stankus, plus 0.12 is Nico Vodakovic, in 5th is 41 Frazier. He is 0.32 down from the leader at the moment.
Nicky's coming through turn one on a... Well, never mind. He scraps that attempt. Our lone RB4 in the race, the number 20, is currently sitting 9th with a 57.22. We only have two FXOs today, one of which is in 2nd, the other is in 15th. The number 27 of Stankus comes through turn number 1 on one of his hot laps. This will likely be his final attempt to take the pole from Joe Holmes, unless he opts to run another lap following this one. Nicky as well is on his final attempt at knocking Joe Holmes off of the pole.
With just 20 seconds left, Joe Holmes still on the pole. Can anyone take it from him? I'm not sure, but what do you think of?
The last one left is the 27, unless there's some unprecedented lap time from another one of the competitors. Stankus ran a 30.79, which is right on with his lap, which he ran earlier and got second. He only needs to gain 0.03 in the final sector here, so we'll see if he can do it. He's coming off of the final turn, up, down the back, the front straightaway, underneath the bridge, and it does not look like he will beat Joe Holmes. No, he does not. 56.94. Not good enough to knock off Joe Holmes. It would appear Joe Holmes has wrapped up the pole for today's race, and therefore a finish of second or better will clinch the championship for Joe Holmes. It is up to Isaac Price and Nikifor Dakovic to take that from him, if one of them should want to win this championship. It will be tough to beat Joe today, as always.
Yeah, so as I said before, Joe Holmes never finished worse than third. The chat opens, and we're about to start the race sometime soon. Need to sort the tracker out and put check the flag out. Everyone has now crossed the line. So, the results of the qualifying, I'll read them out in one moment. I get the most recent copy of the results from the tracker. So, the results from Group 1 and 2 qualifying combined is as follows. Number 36, Joe Holmes, takes the pole with a 56.78. He did that on lap, his 12th lap. Second is Mandigas Stankus with a 56.81. He is the fastest FXO in second on lap 11. Isaac Price takes third place with a 56.9. He did it on his 10th lap. Nikifor Dakovic right down in fourth place with a 56.95. He did it on lap 11. Visa in the number 41 is fifth with a 57.1. He did it on lap 18. Sixth is number 79 R2 again, sorry, I can't pronounce his name. 57.12. He did it on his second lap. Reno Coots did well for 7th in the number 16 car with a 57.13. 8th is number 77, Robin Triscops, with a 57.19. He did that on lap 17. 20 is in 9th. He did a 57.22. 65 is the 10th place car for Core Racing in the XRT with a 57.22. 0.31A. Right, he's going to point out that number 20 is the only RB4, and he got 9th, which is a very good time for the RB4. I can't drive any of these cars fast, but he did very well to go up to 9th. Here we see the rescue car coming into our shot now. That's driven by Jonathan Palmer from New Dimension Racing. He joined the administration team today, helping out with stewarding, rescue unit, and other things. So, this is the New Dimension Racing rescue unit car. Rescue car skin. Very well designed. I do. It's a regular scene on any racetrack in LFS now. There's quite a lot in the series. There is the realistic NASCAR rescue unit skin. That is the standard one for realistic NASCAR. Quite a good skin. All realistic NASCAR events have that skin. Again, there is the pace car. Hopefully not going to be seen too many, but hopefully nothing major will happen. Hopefully we won't have any red flags or anything like that. But that's probably the, now the commentator's curse, and there will probably be a red flag now. And Showbiz tweets, why haven't you tried to say my full name? You are always saying Showbiz because I can't pronounce anyone's name. That's the problem with international series like Realistic NASCAR and mostly all other series. I'm extremely terrible at pronouncing names. I do apologize. But, I believe the last stream of the year for myself. I know I'm not the most entertaining commentator, and I do apologize. I do try my best, but I'm gonna have a break from commentators for a bit. Actually, let's go to really some nice little thread on the LFS forum and see the next series that's coming up. So the 2013 Realistic NASCAR Cup Series is starting off round one with the IndyCar 250. It's 135 laps of KY1 in the FX-F08 on January the 6th at 1500 GMT. The Kyoto 400 is round two with 216 laps of KY1 with the XRR. February the 17th. The Fernbay 150 150 laps at FE24 with the XRT. That's the small up and downhill oval that isn't used in most series, but can bring up some quite good racing with the XRT. We had a test race a few weeks ago, and it worked quite well, thankfully. That's round three on March the 3rd. The Stock Car 250 is 135 laps with KY1, the FZR, on April the 21st. Round five is the Roadster 175 with 95 laps with KY1 with the LX6. That should be interesting. On May the 19th. And finally, rounding out that series is round six is the Horsepower 200 with 108 laps of KY1 with the FZ5 on June the 9th. Both round 1 and 2 will be streamed by myself, hopefully. I'll be making custom graphics so it'll look a bit better, but hopefully you'll join us for that. And we are almost ready to release. I'm gonna set the tracker up so it didn't go berserk at myself. The race director just lining up the grid, making sure everyone's in the correct place so that the start is clean. So I'll just take a short break while we wait for the race to start. I think we're gonna go for a start at 1700 GMT, if I'm not mistaken. We have currently low wind and a clear day here at the Aspen Cadet Circuit. So, race director Cameron Collins just going through some questions with the drivers and making sure they know what's going to happen on the start and etc. Just a few more minutes until we start, hopefully. So, here are all the links you need for to show to follow us on like us on Facebook at y.ly/bvb. You can follow us on Twitter if you search at Realistic NASCAR, like that in the your graphic here. If you have any questions, ask us with the hashtag WTBOCS, and I'll answer as many questions as I can, if we have any, because we have none at the moment. I'll be happy to ask the administration any questions if you have any. All the links are at the top of your screen throughout the stream. They'll be keep rolling, hopefully. Tracker link is also there at the top. The tracker is on the right. That will have the results on when I put the right address in for the race. Not correct. He's messing up. Okay, for some reason, and I can't get the mobile tracker to work. Hopefully, it will come back on some point. Actually, I'm not sure on that, so I'm not sure why that's doing that. Qualifying tracker worked, but can't use that in race. Updating. Well, here we go for the start. I'll turn the tracker off so you're not distracted by it or anything. Moment. So we'll look. Oh, so there's a rolling start for the race, as I haven't put race in the tracker. I think that's why, because I didn't put race in the tracker, so the tracker should work now as the pace car pulls away for the rolling. There is a rolling lap, so we'll have one rolling lap. Hopefully, if my thing is working. Reload the tracker. There we go, we're on pace lap now. Finally working. So the pace car driven by Sobis again, sorry, I can't pronounce your name. leads the field around the course. Just one rolling lap here. And we should be going. So Joe Holmes on pole, followed by the number 27 Stankus, with the number 99 Isaac Price behind. The field is now bunching up. And the pace car is doing one more lap. So there is two pace laps. Now means the tracker will be messed up. So I'll have to add another lap. So it is happy. So everyone is now doubling up for the double valve start. So Joe Holmes will take the inside line, obviously, because that's the inside of the first corner. So our two Russia units following behind. We'll go back to Joe Holmes in the double five position, going almost onto the front straight. The pace car is about to pull off. If the race car is the race car, the race director is happy. Reminder there from Kevin Collins not to overtake before the line. The safety car pulls into the pit lane, waiting for the green flag. For him to wait for Joe Holmes to go, and green flag, there we go. The green flag is out, and we're racing for the final round of the World TBO Championship Series. Everyone into the first corner. Everyone seemed to be quite tidy through there. See anything wrong at the back? One car there, but I'm not sure why. Oh, it's the number 20! Oh no! The number 20, who, I think started 9th, is now all the way down in 18th. So, bad start to his race, unfortunately. We have a car spun, I think. I'm not sure who that was. It was the number 88 car who didn't get spun or was spun, or spun himself. Bill Holmes obviously takes the fastest lap of a 59.84. Obviously, these cars are full of fuel and on clean, on old tyres, so we just saw the 55 go off slightly. The drifting action from the top of the corkscrew type corner there. As Dakovic, is it Dakovic? Yes, Dakovic goes for a pass on Isaac Price, and Isaac, he does it. Dakovic does pass Isaac, and so does Stankus. He is up now to third. Quite a bunched up pack with the these four cars here. So I'm not 100% sure of numbers, but everyone's still quite close. And a few backrunners, a few groups emerging. I hope you won't get any major incidents. So everyone going single file most of the way through the laps, count them down. So Joe Holmes does a 157.54, which is now the fastest lap of the race. This pack, and it's another pack as well. So, waiting here. Oh, too wide. The number 20 now up to 16. On board from his view. Oh, and someone goes wide, but comes back onto the track. In the corkscrew corner, the number 20 goes. He's trying on the outside of the last corner. Doesn't always work, but can sometimes. Oh, and it does work this time. He passes the number 38, and he is now up to 15th. After his spin or whatever happened on the first lap, he is now making his way back through the pack, thankfully. So, he will look to get higher and higher throughout the race. Looking at the front now, Dakovic just behind Joe Holmes. Well, Joe Holmes has pulled a big lead already. Obviously, he's going for the World TBO Championship Series title. So he needs second or better because of his pole to win the title. Dakovic does a fastest lap and a number 3rd disconnect. Dakovic does his lap with a 57.26. He's now the fastest lap holder. But number 30 disconnects, and I think that was a very quick for some reason. So he is now out of the race. So, the pack back here, these three cars, the number 79, 77, and 41. Be quite close, using the little draft that these cars produce, but it can help. If you have any questions, please use the hashtag in Twitter WTBOCS and I'll answer any questions that you send me. 41 is looking to. Who's that? Then I can't see from this view. It's 41? He's 41, he's now promoted up to 6th place. The number 20 is right back down in 17th. We had another problem, it looks like. He does have to really push to get anywhere now. He is quite a long way away from 16th. Only 17 cars on the track at the moment. But Dakovic, hunting down Joe Holmes, who is not as much but still ahead than he was before. 1.75 seconds difference between those two. So, what car is it? The 96 is the first car to make a pit stop. The worst year ever of the pit lane as he comes out now. He is now in 17th. Obviously, the number 20 has just passed him. He is now up to 16th position. Isaac Price closing the gap on the number 27 car, that's Bangers in the 27. Steady pace is sometimes the answer to these races, not all the time, but looking after the tyres is obviously very important in these races, as if you destroy your tyres you can't race on anything. So towards the end of the race, I expect some punches. Hopefully not too many, because and they shouldn't affect it affect the result too much, because quite a short track, so cars can get back to the pit lane quite fast. But there are if tyres do go when on well. Just here, for example, going to the corner, and it goes there, gonna go straight into the gravel, and that could be the end of your race. That probably would bring out a safety car, which is also a possibility. There's not usually many incidents on this track, so the TV director just lost connection and came back on again. So the number 30 is our first time of the day. That was the 38 car going a bit wide. There. This is the last position, number 96, who is getting caught by Joe Holmes just a few. Tenths of a second behind, this is a view from Joe Holmes now. My TV director need to be installed. And get it restarted here again. And a bit more interesting. Start it now. Connect. My TV should gooey up. Sorry for this at the moment. This to work. Eight laptops. But anyway, reconnect to that. So go back to the LFS screen. So we'll go through the current running order. So Cameron Coyne is going to be in the commentary box for the moment. Cameron, do you want to go through the top 5 or 10 drivers?
I can definitely do that. Running first presently is the number 36 of Joe Holmes, who has a 0.81 second lead over second place, the number 09 of Nikifor Dakovic. In third, 3.27 seconds back of the lead is Magungas Stankis in his number 27 FXO. In fourth is number 99, Isaac Price. 41, I'm not going to attempt the name, I'm sorry. 41 is in, well now, is in sixth place as the number 79 of Yelastolo has moved past him into fifth. Raymond Frischtops in the number 77 currently runs in sixth position. Vladimir Pitkinen runs in the eighth position in his number 33 Core Racing XRT. Frankie Schnitzley runs in ninth in his number 22 XRT. Ronald Compars runs in 10th place in his number 95 XRT. The number 88 of Snynczyk runs in 11th. The 38 FXO of, sorry, I'm not going to attempt that name, is in 12th. The 34 runs in 13th, the 55 runs in 14th, and the 20 runs in 15th, rounding out the lead lap. Ronald Crumpus has made a pit stop and now finds himself just behind the leaders, one lap down in 16th position. Currently out of the race is Reno Kootz and one other.
I think number 30.
Okay. And that would round out the running order.
Thank you, Cameron.
Yep. Dakovic is chasing down his championship rival presently. He is running. Oh, and there's a car off in front of them near the downhill chicane. He remains out of the way, and we will remain green.
That's the number 20 car. He's having a few problems in this race. Unfortunately, he did start in 9th, which is a good position for the RB4, but after a few spins and incidents, he is now a lap down. Unfortunately, he is the second car, one lap down. Hopefully there will be no more, but he goes wide again. Four-wheel drive in the RB4, the FXO is front-wheel drive, like this one here. This is the highest FXO, the number 27 of Vindigus Stankers,
The 99 has just passed him a few seconds ago while the 20 was having an off-course excursion. And number 20 joins the spectators after a crash in the final turn.
That we have 63 laps remaining at the current moment, according to TV Director, anyway. Not really sure on the tracker lap time counter. To see it was entering. I can't work it out at the moment.
Perhaps it's not compensating for the fact that there were two base laps.
Yeah, I added another lap, but I'm not sure if it went weird or something.
Up front, Nicky has closed in on the rear bumper of Joe Holmes. Coming through turn number one, they are only 0.3 seconds apart from one another. Now remember that should Nicky beat Joe, it would not matter so long as Joe was able to continue to run in second place. One other competitor would have to finish in between Joe and Nicky in order for Nicky to go home with the title today. Nicky has been running a rather aggressive line through the upper part of the downhill chicane. He seems to cut the first corner very sharply while Holmes attempts to remain on the tarmac most of the way down that corner. So.
So they go into the first corner. Underbreaking is the easiest place to obviously pass another competitor, but very close between these two cars now, you can see from the onboard from Nicky Dakovic. I think the first sector, Dakovic is the fastest, but in the other two, I don't think he is, but we'll see his line down here. You see both cars there taking to grass as well, which I think is legal. There's time for that.
So long as they have two of their tires on the racing surface, which includes the curbing.
Yes, that is a legal line, but it depends on the driver if they feel like it's making them faster. A little more gap between these two cars on this lap, but the battle continues.
Joe's tires are a little bit warmer than Nicky's, however, not by a whole lot.
Thank you. of a gap between those two cars at the minute, but between turns 1 and 2 I see that they're mostly together, getting on this lap as much, but still about a car's length away.
Our leaders are coming up on a lap car this time. The 55 is about to become the, well, second car running one lap down here very, very shortly. Unless there is some kind of intervention of a safety car. It appears though he's about to one lap down. And it would appear he will do so this time through turn number one.
Two homes. That car in between himself and Nicky, or not, the 55 does move over for Nicky Dakovic. So these two battle on to the lap traffic.
Joe's been able to extend his lead up to 2/3 of a second over Nicky. Running in third place is the third place in the championship. Number 99, Isaac Price, is 4 seconds back of the leader. Fourth place in the championship is also running in fourth place. He is 8 seconds back of the leader in his FXO. That is the number 27 of Magungas Stankus.
Number 20 seems to Joe's disconnected. I didn't see that. The 20 has disconnected. So the we have no RB4s now. Just FXOs and XRTs. It is our third retirement of the day.
That leaves us with only 15 cars in this race. This race has set a low of 18 competitors starting on the season, and that could be attributed to the GT1 World Series race yesterday.
Nicky Dakovic still trying to catch Joe Holmes, but Joe Holmes and Indrabine have found a little bit more pace at the moment. Breaking to see both of them in the shot. Actually, quite a small circuit. Breaking to Celine, obviously, the key. Smoothness is also good, except on the Porsche, which is always a annoying corner, shall we say, to get right. Eyes can go off quite easily. As we can see here, because of the drifting or the sliding from the car. Thank you.
Every time Dakovic is able to close the gap on Joe, Joe is able to find some pace and speed away. It leads me to wonder, is Joe actually just conserving his tires and doing what it takes to remain in front of Nicky? As Nicky comes into the second sector and gains a tenth of a second in that front section of the track. A long race to go still. We are, counting the pace laps, we are 30 of 83 completed, meaning that there are still 53 laps remaining in this event. So a long time to close up a gap or earn a gap over your competitors at this time. Go ahead.
Also, Pit Stop will play a big part in this race. I think there'll be obviously some pit stops for tires. The back runner there. Moving over for the first and second drivers. Blue flags have been the topic of the forum posts on this track. I just quite short circuit there, everyone expected a lot of blue flags, but I haven't seen many so far. We have got over the half a race to go, so can still happen, but with only 15 cars currently driving, it's a wonder if we will have any more lapped cars holding up the front few cars.
And this is the 38 FXO moving aside for the leader. Just behind our leaders, we have the 38 and the 34. I do believe they're fighting for position. Yes, they are, for the 12th position.
So, XRT versus FXO. Isaac Price is behind them, waiting to get past at some point. You have to remember that the drivers who are being lapped are still racing, so it's going to be sometimes when some drivers expect them to move over, stop and let them pass, but that's racing. The lap guys do have are allowed to stay on their line, as long as the don't fight or block the lapping car. It's well within rules. As 88 passes the 38. 88 is now in 11th. Joe, let's have a rundown of the five drivers according to the track when the next reloads. Here we go. So, Joe Holmes is still in first on lap 33. Nicky Dakovic is in second, the 09 car. 0.47 of a second down, then 5.03 seconds down with him is Isaac Price. Biggest Stankus is 4 with the number 27 FXO, the highest FXO. He is 4.34 down from Isaac Price. Number 41, Riza, in the IMAX Racing. IAction Team Sports XRT is in 5th, 0.57 of a second down from Stankers. So with either 49 or 48 laps remaining, I still don't know what. So there are 48 laps now remaining. So I think the tracker and the team director, TV director, are now in sync with the laps. So, to the front battle again. Dakovic and Holmes still fighting for third and second place. Not one of the easier tracks to drive these cars, to be honest. Tyreway is the big issue, especially down the corkscrew type corner, and it can your tyres up quite a lot. They're all close together. We do have another battle. Oh, same battle. We do have another battle here. This is number 27 and 41. This is fighting for third position. Quite close here. Oh, Archie Price times out. The fourth in championship times out. I'm not sure we'll be allowed to rejoin, but his laps will be tracked still by the live tracker. Being the race director, they're gonna. He loses connection again. We'll have to know this time that every lap that he is off the server will not be scored. So very unfortunate for our fourth in the championship. As Core Racing, one of the Core Racing guys accidentally hits a button, I think. Okay. Tyre Bright joins yet again. One of the problems with sim racing is not just about the car and driving the team, it's about internet connection, computer performance, and a lot of other things. It's gonna be quite hard to get everything working directly together, but it does happen. It can be good, but it can be bad. So apparently, Nicky has been is intentionally hitting someone else. As a few drivers blocking their messages now, so it does affect them. As I hear Price yet again times out, bad connection with him. That's not good, especially in the last race of the season.
Good battles going on between the leaders and the 27 and 41 in third and fourth place. They are also nose to tail. the 41 has caught up to the 27, as I believe his tires have plagued him this whole race. You can see at the F9 screen that his right front tire is orange and red in color on the display, and it would appear that he may be forced to pit as the tread on his tires are wearing down. That would eliminate the third place driver from the picture of the race win, as the 41 takes a peek underneath and thinks the better of it.
You're very close between these two. Ice Price yet again joined and straight away leaves the pit in case. What he wants, digging to the rear bumper of 27. More people blocking and blocking their messages. Trying to get the draft. Draft at your best here, but I think the 41 is going to go for a undertake. Goes into the inside. He does pass, but can he hold it? Look, it does look like, and he does. He has now passed. The 41 has now passed the 27, and the 41 is now in third place. Joe Hung and Dagovic still with a gap, 0.8 of a second they were last time the track updated. They in about that around the whole course, but everything can change with 41 laps remaining. We're about halfway now, so tires could be getting quite hot and worn now. Not sure if pit stops will be needed. I think maybe. I don't think so on fuel. Ice Price chats again without permission. Restricted, he's probably not too happy about that. He is currently still driving, but he is stone dead last in 50th position. 7 laps down. Not good for the 4th driver who's in 4th in the Drivers' Championship. Also won't help his team in its racing. Not as many in his racing team cars as usually, I don't think. But still every point counts. See if we can find any battles. Or if we see 79 in the grass there. Right, Chris Fox in the number 77 tearing down the court crew, gaining on the 79 car. This is also about 95 and 88 in their battle. Sort of, there's quite a distance between them, but I do class that as a battle. So, points changing at badge for 9th position, so positions always changing on these races. See if we have any Why is your place seem to have turned out or something again? I think. Still racing? I see him on the thing. No, he's not on the track. I didn't see him. Left the pitch and then... Oh, he did, he joined the spectators, so... that is a retirement for Ice Price. Unfortunately, that may change his championship position as he does disconnect. Unfortunate for him, but... connection problems are always... a problem on sim racing events like this one.
As the leaders finish up sector one, they close in on the, I believe, on the, oops, sorry about that, on the 9th and 10th place competitors, who are about to go laps down. Coming off the final turn, we will see how the gap between our front two is. At the line, Nikki is 0.93 seconds behind Joe. In third place is the 41, who is 12 seconds back. Fourth is Stankus, who is 14 and a half back. The 79 is in fifth place, 22 seconds behind. The 77 is 24 seconds behind in sixth place. Seventh place, Vladimir Pikkanen, is 25 seconds behind the race lead, 26. In 8th place is the 22, in 9th is the 88, and rounding out the top 10 and about to be lapped by the leader is the number 95 of Ronald Kapars, who at the line has been lapped by Joe Holmes. In 11th is the 34, 38 is in 12th. The other FXO in the field, other than the 27 of Stankus, who is in 4th. The 55 of Sullenbaum is in 13th, and his number 55 XRT. And rounding out those who are still running almost two laps down is Ronald Kompas and his XRT. Up front, Joe has almost a second lead over Dakovic, and looking at their tires, at just past the halfway point, one may wonder, will they have to pit? Nikki makes contact with the number 88, a lap car. Through the final turn, he gets it back under control and returns upon his way. That will hurt Nikki's chances as he falls to almost 2 seconds behind Joe at this point. With 13 laps to go, the question does become, will anybody have to pit for tires before the end of this event? Perhaps if Nikki could push Joe hard enough, they would both have to pit, or perhaps only Joe would be required to pit. That would be Nikki's ultimate goal, but looking back in the field, the best tire wear appears as though it is on the number 77 in 6th place. If everybody else would have to pit, perhaps he would be able to stay out and continue and perhaps steal a win away from those who are up and towards the front. The number 38 FXO has considerable wear on his right front, as well as Stankus in fourth position in his FXO. However, his Stankus is considerably better than the 38s.
Both FXO's showing that the front wheel drive heats up the tires more. Usually, after a while, the temperatures will level out and there shouldn't be as much wear. But those cars possibly they could be in the pit soon. Not sure if you can. Do you think you can go full race on a tank of fuel?
Easily. They may be only be running about 2/3 of a tank.
The fuel won't be a problem unless they've set it too low. And see one of those last lap dash for the pits. Or roll to the line.
Which, reminder, Joe Holmes did on our last visit to this track at Austin, at the north reversed course. Joe Holmes was forced to pit from the lead with only 2 or 3 laps to go in order to take more fuel. Perhaps we would see this again. One would pray that we do not, but you never know. Yes, you'd hate to see a championship go away from one because of a mistake such as that.
Any slight miscalculation can ruin a race, like it was on that day. Even more of a gap between Dakovic and Joe Holmes now. All about tire. Keeping the tires at a minimum wear and temperature, but continuing at a fast pace.
Nicky gained some ground on Joe that lap. You might wonder if Nicky's sole goal in this event is to push Joe to the point where he would have to pit, and then Nicky would hope that he wouldn't have to as a result. That being that should Nicky beat Joe to the finish, he would still not win the championship due to the 5 bonus points given to Joe for winning the pole. One may wonder if he may just push him until he begins to show wear. Of course, he would still have to beat him and not have to pit himself in order to win the championship, but that may be one thing that Nicky has on his mind.
Also forcing in Joe Holmes into a wear of the tires or mistake. Mistakes here, especially the turn before the corkscrew. Go wrong there and you can hit the wall quite hard or even go to the gravel on the corkscrew. And it's not that easy to get off the LFS wall sometimes. It can put you in and hook you, put
No, in fact, if you missed this portion here before the downhill chicane, the tire barrier comes out and creates a rather sharp protrusion in the wall at that point that competitors I've seen run into while practicing. That could really ruin one day if they run off at the exact wrong position on that little double apex corner.
With 28 laps remaining now.
I do believe that Nicky will have to pit. His right rear has run rather low on tread. Now the question becomes, how much more will it take before it pops? And will, like I say, is anybody else going to have to pit? Will Nicky actually have to pit as I anticipate this? Could become a rather interesting race with pit stops and all that on the such. You would believe that Nicky would notice that and back his pace down, allowing Joe to conserve as well, but perhaps if Joe's tires became to the point where they would pop, he could in fact slow down and have a 15-second lead over third place, which is he would only have to finish second in order to clinch the championship after clinching the pole earlier today.
Nice third place, number 41, passing lapped traffic.
He has pulled considerably away from Stankus in his FXO recently. Stankus's right front on that front wheel drive machine has leveled out its wear for the most part, while the Holt, he seems to have backed down his pace considerably in order to make an attempt to finish without stopping. It seems that the right rear on the FXOs is the one which is causing troubles at this track here, being that there's such sharp corners and the power getting it down and trying to get out of the corner, along with sliding into the corner trying to push your vehicle, seems to be the most worn down tire on the XRDs. I was speaking to some of the competitors, and I myself from personal experience know that at a track such as this, your right side tires will be angled to the right side of the car, unlike a typical road course. The setup would look more like an oval track setup than a road course setup on a track such as this, being that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 right or left hand turns and only 2 minor left hand turns. If you're just joining us, we have 8 cars on the lead lap. Today's race is paced by Joe Holmes, who has a 1.64 second lead over Nikifor Dakovic and a commanding lead over our championship battle, with Nikki happening to win the race and Joe would be required to finish third or worse at this time after Joe has clinched the pole. Third is the 41 XRT of Lehtomäki, the 27 FXO of Magunga Stankus for Last Lap Motorsports runs in fourth place. Fifth place is the number 79 of Yelastalo. In his number 79 XRT, the number 77, the number 79's NX Racing teammate in his XRT is in 6th place. The number 33 XRT of Vladimir Pitkinen is in the 7th position. In 8th place is Frankie Snitsity in 8th position in his 22 XRT. First car one lap down at this time is the number 88 of Snitsilik in his XRT. The 95 is just behind him while receiving a blue flag from the 4th place competitor. He is currently running in 10th in his 95 that is driven by Ronald Kapars. The 34 XRT of Horsvik is in 11th. The 38 FXO, who is showing considerable tire wear to the point where he may blow a tire at any moment, hopefully not, but for him, it doesn't look good. He is running in 12th position, almost 2 laps down. The leader is directly behind him, getting ready to put him a second lap down. The 55 is in 13th position, just in front of the 96. Of Ronald Crumpus. Those two are both 2 laps down. There are 14 competitors still in today's race. We started with 18, and this is the lowest attended race of our season so far. To date, the races have had consistently in the 20s as far as lap count. We had one race with 29 competitors, another with 28, and two with 24, along with one with 25 competitors. Looking at the historical race statistic page on the LFS forums under Realistic NASCAR / World TBO Championship Series, we have had no lead changes as Joe Holmes started on the pole, held the lead, and continues to by 1.8 seconds over Dakovich. And we have had no safety cars, yellow flags, at this point in time. I believe we've only had two safety cars over the course of this entire series. And right now it would appear as Joe Holmes comes out of Sector 1 and gains another tenth of a second over Dakovich, it would appear as though the World TBO Championship Series championship will be awarded to Joe Holmes following today's event. However, there are still 20 laps to go at the line, or 21 currently, and anything can happen, as we have learned. As Dakovich closes down the lead by 1/3 of a second on that lap.
The fastest lap is still held by Nicky Dakovic, 57.2. So he's still showing pace, but still unable to close the gap significantly enough to Joe to pass him. But just passing him is not enough, remember. Joe Holmes would have to finish third or worse. But, depending on tires and calculations of fuel, 20 laps remain in a race.
Our leader has just now put the 34 another lap down. I believe he is currently running in the 11th position. He is now 2 laps down to the leader, Joe Holmes. Nicky seems to have closed the gap once again on Joe. Wonder if Nicky is now really trying to push Joe, because looking at Nicky's tires, they continually deteriorate. One is now down to 0.85 seconds, the gap between first and second place. But Nicky is really pushing his car visibly. You can hear it slide through the corners and make you wonder, maybe he just doesn't care if his tires blow out. Suppose it's all or nothing for him at this point. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in today so far. I hope that you've enjoyed this somewhat enjoyable event. Hopefully we will be able to see some more competitors at this event or in our series period next year, as there was not a single event in which we were able to have a full field, while we were able to get rather close in most events this year. There will be a schedule discussion and poll eventually at some point if you are wanting to participate in next year's World TBO Championship Series. There will be a poll up on the TBO Championship Series subform of the LFS forums, in which everybody will be permitted to have a say in what tracks we'll be attending next year. A lot of talk has been given, or a lot of advice has been given to me, and from that advice I will be compiling a poll in which you will be able to select the different tracks in which you would like to attend next year for this series. We're probably going to look at a more varied schedule than this year. Maybe last 2 years have been rather similar with KY2 and FE3 being knocked out this year in favor of SO5R. quite a few of the typical tracks. We did reverse, for example, West Hill, we ran the reverse configuration, and AS North, we ran the reverse configuration, but we're gonna try to look at different racetracks entirely for next year, other than their traditional Blackwood 200 and West Hill. This year it was the 207, last year it was the 20, or GP. We'll be looking at some different options for all of the other events. However, if you would like to return to these ones that we went to this year, that will be more than okay if you do not want the change that has been suggested by many of our competitors.
It has been quite close racing throughout the series. There's simply two or three packs in the point standings of people with close points. But obviously the top two, Joe Hungy and Nicky Dakovic, being one of the closest. Obviously the 2013 series of the World TBO Championship Series should be live streamed every race, hopefully. Been a bit hit and miss with the stream this year, but now, very much thanks to simrace.tv, hopefully we'll have more and more races streamed, as well as the IndyCar 250 and the Kyoto 400 coming next year. Joe Holmes and Nicky Dakovic again. 1.95 difference at the line that time. So Joe seems to be pushing, or Dakovic seems to be holding off for his tyres. The number 38 car is extremely thin. Rubber tyres, well, obviously rubber tyres, thin tyres on his front right, possibly blowout, almost. Also, you get the FXO with even one blown tyre, in the gravel, thanks to its front wheel drive, it can get stuck quite easily. The gravel tracks, not the strongest in LFS than some other games and mods, but it's good and bad. It's good for the drivers, but not that realistic. But hopefully the new updates soon to come to LFS, which hopefully get more features such as strongest gravel traps. We are currently running the 0.6E patch on the server that we are coming from now. That patch includes some multiplayer issue resolution because there was some hackers to get in to servers without usernames, not allowing admins to ban or kick them. So that was a problem that was resolved. Also, with faster loading times on multiplayer servers, also a good thing. Also, Shift P and Shift S you can do now while new guests are connecting. Always annoying. Is this a battle? Yes, it is. A battle here for fifth place between 77 and 77, quite close, with only 13 laps remaining, so about 10 minutes of the race now. Let's have a look at the front There's still a big difference between Joe Holmes and Nicky Dakrovic. As the 77 looks up the inside on the exit, will he get it done? I'm not sure. Does he have the inside line? Oh no, he doesn't. He ducks back behind the 79. The 79 does take the inside line just so the 77 could not pass. Really close now. Pass could happen here any moment. Easiest points to overtake are the first and last corner. A lot of braking in those corners, so it can be quite easy sometimes to get the inside line, but it's still a bit difficult. Yeah, still on the rear bumper of the 79.
Contact.
Only a little bit of contact, but he tries up the inside again. Not sure if we'll go back behind. Do you have the inside line? There is overlap here. Do you have the inside line? Under braking now.
Oh, it's a peak, but not. It's not there.
No.
Allows the 79 to pull away.
Good defending by the 79 there. He's getting the power on just early enough to keep the 77 behind.
NX Racing. These two competitors. Their team has clinched the team's championship, if I am not mistaken. Definitely after this race they will have, but I believe the team championship will go to NX. I think they had the most podiums of any team. The closest teams to them were My3ID, with only Joe influencing their points total. In the series, only the best two finishers from each team contributed to a team's points total. Every driver on every team contributed to the tiebreaker statistics, which in the team championship and nations championship will basically become irrelevant.
Nine laps remaining. Could be close on tyres. The number 38 still has extremely thin tyres. Thank you, actually, permission from Cameron Corns, I'll be commentating here, to text chat. Got blue flags there. Oh, and the 77, oh my god, didn't even see that. The 77. Oh. No, sorry.
Wait, 79 will have an inside on the first set of these two corners, but the 77 will have the inside on the second of them. But the 79 is able to clear, and there's a little bit of contact between these two, but they continue as they were running. 79 in front of the number 77 still. This has been turning into quite a battle. The 77 has considerably warmer rear tires, but it doesn't appear that it will be an issue in these final seven laps once they get to the line. Checking in up front, Joe continues to have a 1.8 second lead over Dakovic coming into the final corner here, coming to take the 6 laps to go.
This fight between the 77 and the 79 seemed to be dissolved a bit, but the braking will know if it has or not. And I'm pulling away a bit more now. What about braking on this horse? And good exit is always good. Okay. This is 77. Majorly taken to the grass there to try and get down the cut-through corner. as fast as possible. That battle seems to have resolved. Fill with their gap with them. 7 laps remaining. Not sure if Joe Holmes will get down to third, but anything can happen in racing, especially sim racing, because connection problems and we call lag, it can come into play a lot.
At this point, Nicky has nothing to lose. Nothing at all. Should, with Isaac being out of the race, should Nicky go and make a dive bomb attempt on the 36, there is no way that the 36 should battle him, should he get up there. Of course, the prestige of winning a race over your nearest competitor in the championship may factor into that, but should he be championship-minded, he would simply let the 09 go if he was caught. I don't believe Joe will have that to worry about, though. It would appear, unless something crazy happens, that Joe should cruise on to the win and the championship. But as you say, nothing can be fully anticipated in sim racing. There are 5 laps remaining. There'll be one lap car in the picture coming down to the finish. It'll be the 96 of Ronald Crumpus. He will likely give way shortly and leave the battle down to Nicky and Joe Holmes. As Joe comes across the line, there are 4 laps remaining in this event. And with that lap, Joe Holmes ties Nicky Dakovich in the fastest lap battle for 1 bonus point. That bonus point will be largely irrelevant in this event and championship battle. However, we will probably be awarding a point to each competitor should there be a tie. Joe's advantage over Nicky has now increased to 2 seconds flat. The 77 and 79 battle for the final position in the top 5 has heated back up, with them getting ready to reach the second sector on the track. That would put them at 2.5 laps remaining, and 77 is right on the tail of the 79. Seven getting a little loose out of the downhill chicane. Oh, both of them run a little wide. 77 a little bit wider than the 79. You're not missing anything up front. The championship contenders in first and second place remain static. Their advantage is largely the same. Two laps to go for championship, and race leader Joe Holmes, 1.7 seconds, his advantage over second place. Just in front of them, the 33 and 22 XRTs are in a little bit of a battle, though there's some distance between them two. They will likely complete the full race distance on the lead lap, making there only 8 cars on the lead lap. There are still 14 cars running. And we've had no lead changes and no yellow flags. Joe Holmes comes off of the final corner and is about to receive the white flag to begin the final lap of this World TBO Championship Series for 2012. Solidly claims the points for best lap. Go ahead.
Oh, you don't want to say that.
Joe comes down to complete the first sector for the final time. His lead over Dakovich is now 2.12 seconds.
Along the front straight he goes, and across the line, he is the championship winner, making slide for his championship win. Dakovic is in second. I will give you the full results.
Coming down the downhill chicane, the 79 has a slight advantage over the 77 going into this last corner. 77 hard on the brakes, but it would appear too little. Oh, and they're side by side. There's contact. The 77 strikes the 79 on the left rear quarter panel, but it is not enough. The 79 will defeat the 77 to the finish line by mere 2/10 of a second. 7th and 8th place, the 33 and 22 are also battling it out to the line. The 33 has the advantage there, and those two as well finish within a car length. And that would complete the 2012 Realistic NASCAR World TBO Championship Series. First place is Joe Holmes. Second place in this short course 150 is Nikola Dakovic. The 41 of Lim Stemicki finishes 4th. The 27 of Magunga Stankis finishes 4th. The 79 of Yalasilo finishes 5th. Raymond Frischkops finishes 6th. Vladimir Pikkanen finishes 7th. Frankie Schmidt-City finishes 8th. 9th is Slimevizek in the 88, and 9th. 10th place is the 95 of Ronald Kapars, and in 11th is Korsvik. In 12th place is the FXO of Norskanesharash, who finished in 12th. And in 13th is Ronald Kompas, and in 14th is the 55 of Sombom. And I'm going to sign off for just a second.
So, a very exciting season of road cycling race. A few close battles, especially between the 77 and 79. A close racing, then a bit more than close contact there, but very well done to all the drivers in the race today. A mere 14 drivers finished, 4 retirements. Kasper Kontio with the first to retire. He spectated on within the first quarter or half of this race. Renaud Coutts was the second retirement. The number 20 was the third, and unfortunately Isaac Price was the fourth running driver's championship driver. I'm not sure if he is now. I'll have to wait for the points to come up. He had a timeout and then reconnected, then timed out again. So he was the fourth and final retirement of the day, I'd like to say an extremely massive welcome. Thank you to every driver who raced in the series today. Well, not today, but the whole season. We had 59 starters in we had 59 cars who did at least one race in the whole series over the 6 rounds. The teams, we had 23 separate teams who have started at least one race, and we had 27 different nations that did at least one race. You see Nicky Dakovic there rowing away from the line and come back again. Very well done to him. Quite close battling with Joe Holmes there. Very well done to him. So, hopefully we'll get Cameron back anytime soon, and we'll have a quick interview with you, Will.
I'm still here.
Oh, hello. How do you think this round went?
Probably the attendance was rather disappointing, but overall the racing was not all that bad. It was pretty good, actually, through the field. In 3rd and 4th place we had a battle, and 6th and 7th we had a battle, and, well, 5th and 6th, and then 7th and 8th we also had a battle. And the lead battle was not too bad either. It was rather good. I think if Isaac Price would have remained, it would have even been more exciting, because I think he may have had something for the leaders there towards the end if they would have gotten battling. He probably would have caught up to them. Overall, it was pretty good. Like I said, I was rather impressed by the maturity level of most of the competitors, if not all. And I thought that they respected each other rather well. It was rather pleasant. It's not something that always happens in LFS when you have leagues and all this amount of people trying to get to the front. But for the most part, it was pretty fair, you might say.
Yeah, it was a very good season. I would say a lot better than last year. Well, a bit better than last year, because I didn't watch all the races last year, but I only saw a few. It was a bit more protests than last year, I think. So, as many protests this year.
Yeah, it was very, like I said, there was a lot of respect. I mean, there was a lot of, the series did point out one or two flaws in the realistic NASCAR rulebook that we're going to review, go over, and have actually already been placed into the fixes for these issues, have been placed into the 2013 realistic NASCAR rulebook, and they'll be ready to go for the realistic NASCAR Cup Series, which will begin on January 6th in the IndyCar 250. Those will already be in there by then, and in fact they'll actually be in there for the first Open Series race. The Indianapolis 50 kilometers is on December 30th. I'm going to have to change the entrance date of the rulebook to the 30th of this year to incorporate that event into the new rulebook. I could have released it for the end of this series, but I wanted to make sure that the text was how I wanted it before it became official. But like I said, overall, pretty clean. A lot more interest in the series this year, it would seem. And last year, actually, when we ran this series last year, it was the admin team first experience in administration for most of the components of the team, period. Myself, it was my 3rd or 4th race, all of them on ovals. But all in all, we bonded over the first season last year, and I think this year we continued to run a rather clean administration team, albeit a little inexperienced yet, as opposed to organizations such as NDR.
Yeah, well, I would like to also say a big thank you to simrace.tv. They provided the last two broadcasts and all of their broadcasting is free to anyone. You've got to apply and make sure it's accepted. Then you can use their stream PCs and stream like I'm doing now. I will be streaming the hopefully the IndyCar 250 as well as the Kyoto 400. There will be more than likely a Kyoto 400 qualifying day stream. Not 100% sure about that, but hopefully we'll be doing that. I would like to thank you, Cameron, and everyone in the administration team, as well as all the drivers you have raced in the series throughout the season. And any last words, Cameron?
Just a large thank you to everybody who made this season possible. Without anybody interested, it wouldn't have happened. I'd like to say thanks to those who tuned in and watched today. Hope you enjoyed. I know there's not as many competitors as usual. Not particularly a bad problem to have on a track such as this, but it is what it is. Would you like to get an interview with, see if we can get an interview with Nicky here real fast? I see he just joined.
Yeah, sure, that'll be quite good to the second place, second place driver, championship driver. Here he is now, Nicky Dagovic.
Hello. How are you doing?
Hello. How was the race for you then?
Can you just wait a moment so I make this voice activation?
Yeah.
Alright, hi. The race was really awesome. The qualifying was terrible. And actually, everybody thought that the starting in second group would be advantage, but it was pretty much the same. Still, I had to learn all the wind from watching. Couldn't really find out everything because everybody used different brakes and, you know, setups and this sort of thing. So anyway, did good start, and I think you saw the battling with Isaac. I mean, that guy is just always nuts, you know. So went for it, and this time we didn't crash, and I managed to get up to second. I mean, I don't know why he protested so much. I was completely side by side in the corner, and he just had to give room. Anyway, I had probably the fastest pace in the start, and was really surprised, you know, really, really surprised to be catching Joe. So I catch him really fast, actually, and then I know he start, you know, driving in a way that you can't attack, and I just wait for a mistake, and for like 20 laps I'm right on his tail, but you know, never a chance. And it's really a good race, very fun, but anyway, he did a good race, and he really deserved to win. The season was beautiful. I mean, three pole positions and a lot of podiums, a victory, second overall. And I think the team did a good job as well. Especially in the last round, we finished with four cars all in top 10. We maybe won team championship, even if we will see after points calculate. So I'm really looking forward to the next race. And I mean, the job that Joe did was fantastic because he missed one race, you know. So he made a good comeback, and the points, of course, points system helped him, and Isaac battling with us also, you know, getting involved everywhere. But it's racing, and you can't make people disappear or whatever. So he earned it, and it's probably the way he wanted. At least I gave him a good fight, so we're there. Maybe next time.
Nicky, did it ever go through your head that maybe you could run Joe so hard that he would pop a tire, perhaps?
No. These tires really last maybe... I mean, look at them right now, I didn't spectate. There is a lot of rubber left. So I had to push, you know, and they were actually cooler sometimes than Joe's because, you know, I could switch the cars and see his tires. But if I wanted to attack, I had to really make a huge dive, and that wouldn't be, like, you know, I don't want to win the championship that way. And even if I dived and everything, I still knew that, you know, he would make it easy, and then I would destroy the tires and everything. He would fight back, and I just wanted to pass him, you know, in a way that he wouldn't fight anymore, like I passed Isaac. And I think maybe in the next championship, the good idea would be to have pit stops. I mean, just for strategy's sake, maybe one or two pit stops, because race is really long, and sometimes you just you can't pass somebody, even you're like 0.1 faster, like this time. So maybe have clean air sometimes or something. But that's to discuss on forum. I mean, it's just one idea.
Yeah, it also had the idea of adding, I don't know, you're probably not particularly in favor of it, but adding weight to perhaps the XRT, but I was looking at all kinds of things. I think it's a good, it's difficult to keep the tires on and everything. That's something I was looking at, but yeah, I think you and Joe had a pretty good battle today. I was very impressed with Joe and yourself, how you two were able to put your differences aside after the first round.
Yep.
Nick, or you and Isaac, that was always a tense moment when you two were anywhere near each other. That was always a tense moment. But other than that, things went rather clean.
I'm sorry about the noises in the house. And, well, I don't know about the weight. I mean, it's, you see the tires, they're just dying. Maybe it's better to increase the, or change in the engine restriction. Something like less for FXO or both cars more, so RB4 is more. Nobody drives RB4. I mean, if you look at it, the most quick drivers drive XRT, so I think FXO would be a lot faster if someone like Joe would drive it. You know, he has a lot of world records in that. Anyway, I go now. So thank you for the championship, and see you around.
Yeah, very well done to you, Dakovic. Hopefully see you next season. And are you going to be coming to the National Cup series?
I'm sorry, I hit increase the volume. So if you have question, please. I just heard some cup something.
Are you coming to the NASCAR Cup series?
NASCAR Cup Series. No. Just first time I hear about it. Is it like road racing or?
No, it's over racing. Another one.
Oval race. Well, no. if it's oval racing, then no.
The only event I could see you being interested in is the Fernvale.
Wait, actually, if it's XRT and ovals, maybe I come. I mean, I'll see it around the forums.
Yeah, that's the Fern Bay 150. It's F24, the oval at Fern Bay. That's an XRT.
Hold on.
But anyways, thanks for racing with us, Nikki, and we'll hope to see you about next year soon.
I'm sorry, I just had to shut the door.
Yeah, but anyways, thanks for coming out and racing with us, and we hope to see you soon. If not, then we'll hopefully see you next year.
Yeah, hello to everybody, and follow Ixion on in the GT1 World Series and other leagues. Goodbye.
Yes, good luck with that. See you soon.
Thanks. All right. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
So, again, a big thank you to all the administration team, every racer that has raced in any race, everyone who's joined at home in the live streams. Thank you to everyone in the admin team. Any actual last words, Cameron?
Just a big thank you to Speedy J, Kid222, Sobus, BMW Geek, JSRK for help as well. You, Jonathan, thanks for everything that you've done, the stream, the tracker, all that stuff. And thank you to NDR, Deco Jester. Deco helped out a good bit with the server. And just a big thank you to everybody who made this possible.
Okay, so we'll
also congratulations to Joe Holmes. And it'll be close between Xion and NX teams on the team championship. I would like to correct that. I may have misspoken earlier.
Okay, so we'll see you. Indy 250 will be hopefully the next stream, followed by the Auto 400. So we'll hopefully see you at IndyCar 250. I'm Jonathan Frost. Yeah, thanks to everyone, and goodbye.